You're watching Keystone Science, and in today's episode, we're going to be building a Michelson interferometer and using it to measure the wavelength of light. The first time this experiment took place was back in the 1880s. The Yellow River was flooding, Krakatoa was booming, Edison founded his company, and Michelson and Morley set out to prove the drag coefficient of the ether. Now, the luminiferous ether was the previous physics explanation for how light could exist. Essentially, after Maxwell unified a bunch of equations regarding electricity and magnetism, he found that the differential equation they produced had wave patterns, and moreover, these waves traveled at the speed of light. So, he assumed that was light, and that's what everyone assumed it was. It turns out he was right. But along with this, waves need something to travel through. Waves need a medium. I speak to you, the wave travels through the air. You hit a wall, it travels through the wall. But what was this medium that light traveled through? Because we could send it through vacuums and it would go just fine, so what's going on here? Physicists all turned to some kind of medium that can't interact with matter, but nonetheless is there, called the luminiferous ether. Now, just as if you and I were to get into opposing trains going northbound and southbound, and were to look at each other, we would see each other going faster than the bystander would see us, just because in my reference frame, I'm stationary, and I see the world moving towards me, and you're moving at twice that speed because I'm moving towards you. Then, we would expect light to move faster if we were to be going towards whatever reference frame this luminous ether was in. Now, we like to bag on this idea today, but it's really not that unfounded, because every other thing that satisfies the wave equation does have this sort of shift when we're going towards it. For instance, I'm talking to you, if you were to run towards me, you would record the speed of sound as being faster. So anyways, young Albert Michelson and Edward Morley set out to measure this difference in the speed of light. But to perform this experiment and measure some difference, they needed something moving quite fast. Now, lucky for them, what moves quite fast in the 1880s, and still moves fast to this day? That's right, the Earth. Now, this is an experiment that was very, very foundational towards the forming of modern-day physics, because it failed. In Michelson's own words, "The experiments on the relative motion of the Earth and ether have been completed, and the result decidedly negative. The expected deviation of the interference fringes from the zero should have been 0.4 of a fringe, and the maximum displacement was recorded to be 0.02, and the average much less than 0.01. And then, not in the right place. As displacement is proportional to the squares of the relative velocities, it follows that if the ether does slip past, the relative velocity is less than 1/6 of the Earth's velocity." So in layman's terms, their results showed that there was way, way less of a change in the speed of light based on where the Earth was positioned than what should have been there. Now, rather than just accept that this disproved the ether, many people went about to try and fix the equations of the ether, and they came up with various things, such as Lorentz contraction, which turns out to be a very real phenomenon, but at the time wasn't really founded in anything, it was just an ad hoc solution. But more importantly, this is the experiment that opened up the gates for Einstein's theory of relativity, saying that light must travel at the same speed for whatever observer, non-dependent upon their frame of reference. What we're going to do today is talk about some of the mathematics behind an interferometer, and we're going to construct our very own and use it to measure the wavelength of light. Because this is one of the most precise rulers ever made. In fact, this is the very same technology that was used to measure gravitational waves. So, with that said, let's jump right into it. An interferometer works by first sending light down into a device called a beam splitter. Now, a beam splitter sounds pretty intimidating. However, it's nothing really that you haven't seen. What it means is that it's partially transmissive and partially reflective. So, for instance, if you look at a pane of window and you see a reflection of your face, but yet you can still see through the window, that's an example of a beam splitter. The only difference is, ideally, the beam splitter should be 50-50, meaning 50% of the light gets reflected up and 50% of it gets transmitted through. So effectively what we've done now is created two identical beams that are going in orthogonal directions, which just means that they are perpendicular to one another, 90 degrees apart, which are now going to travel down and hit mirrors and bounce back. Now, after they bounce back, they both hit the beam splitter again. 50% of one of them goes through the beam splitter, the other one has 50% reflected, and those both happen to be in the exact same direction now. They go out and they produce an interference pattern. So now we know roughly what an interferometer is, let's try to understand what the interference comes from. Light still is a wave, and in fact, it's a very nice looking sine wave most of the time, very much like what I have on that oscilloscope down there. Now, waves have a very cyclic nature to them, and the phase of a wave we're going to define to be the part of the sine wave that it's in if we were to look at one wavelength of it. If you're not familiar with it, phase is a measurement that goes from 0 to 2 pi, and it can go further than that, but then we have 3 pi equal to pi, because much like traversing around a clock, we have a repeating nature to it. This means that if we look at the arm lengths between the beam splitter and each of the mirrors, we find that any distance, any change in distance between a beam splitter and a mirror is associated with a change in phase for the wave. Now, assuming we have monochromatic light, which is the experiment we're going to be doing today, meaning that we're just using a laser, it's one light. White light would be an example of non-monochromatic light because it has many frequencies within it. As we superimpose two waves of equal frequency, we can see that shifting the phase of one of them changes the overall amplitude given by the superposition of the two. Now, this superposition of the waves, which effectively just means adding the waves together, is the interference pattern that we see coming out of the Michelson interferometer. So now, using some mathematical formalism, let's look at how we can actually calculate the intensity of the light given off by the interferometer. Let's begin by assuming one of the arm lengths is a distance d greater than the other arm length. Now to find the difference in time that it takes light to travel the two different paths, we're going to say tau is equal to d over the speed of light, c. Now this next part may look a little bit scary to you, because you may not have seen things like imaginary numbers, but rest assured, we are still just adding two waves together. You can in fact do this by just using cosines if you so desire, but it's quite a bit easier to use the complex representation of a wave, which is e to the I theta. Which, if you know Euler's identity, e to the I theta is equal to cosine theta plus I sine theta. So it's really completely fine. And what the physicists will commonly do is at the end of the calculation, they'll take the real part of whatever it is, because that's what's physically important. So, as it turns out, with this kind of notation, we can formalize the electric field of light by the equation E of RT is equal to some magnitude constant multiplied by E to the I multiplied by KR minus omega T, where K is the wave vector and omega is the frequency of light, or specifically the angular frequency. So now with some necessary constants out front, we take the electric field from each of the arms and add them together. One of them is time shifted by tau, the other one is not. Now this already, well and good, will give you a pretty good idea of how bright it will be, but it turns out for intensity, we take the magnitude squared, which means the absolute value squared, which in complex notation is just multiplying by its complex conjugate. So we take that expression of adding the two waves together, and we multiply it by its complex conjugate. Now keep in mind, the coefficients of these two waves are the same because the waves are identical. We sent this through a 50-50 beam splitter, so the only difference is that one of them is time shifted. Effectively, what we're saying is that the intensity is proportional to 1 plus omega tau, where omega is the angular frequency of light, the light that we're using, and tau is the time shift. Now this is really, really, really cool, because this means we can measure such minute changes in spatial difference. So for instance, if we were using a 500 nanometer light source, which is very well in the middle of the visible light spectrum, then a change of 250 nanometers would have a fringe going from completely bright to completely black. And as it turns out, just as a side note, there are many other kinds of things you can do to get even smaller measurements. For instance, later on we'll talk about how particles really have a wave-like nature to them, and so you can actually build matter interferometers, which can measure even smaller areas because their wavelengths are much, much smaller than visible light or even much higher power lights are. So with that all said, let's physically build one of these things. Now, I know a lot of you guys won't be super happy because I'm going to be using an optics kit. You can, of course, do this with much more simple things at home, and I'll even show you how to measure the focal length of a lens because we're going to be using that to collimate light, and you can just use a laser pointer for the laser. In fact, that's what I'm doing here. It's just a laser pointer mounted inside of a steel block. But it will just be quite hard to get those mirrors perpendicular to one another because that's really important for it to be reflecting back and then conjoining in the exact same spot. So you can get the interference patterns. At the end of the day, if you can jerry-rig something and then just carefully move it, you can definitely see where the dots are and you'll just be moving them together, much as we're doing here. So it's not the end of the world. You can do it. Just use some creativity. So the very first thing we want to do is collimate our light. Now, lasers theoretically should be fairly collimated, but it doesn't hurt to get it slightly more collimated. What it means for light to be collimated is that if I were to get my light source and send it off, theoretically, as it would go to infinity, it would stay parallel to one another, meaning that we don't have angles diverging out. Now, light from the sun, for instance, is effectively collimated because the groups of light that hit us are such close angles, because you imagine how far away the sun is, they're such small angles apart from one another that it effectively looks like they're traveling parallel to one another. However, using some physical trickery, we can make it look like the image came from infinitely far away, which produces collimated light. We can do this using two lenses. With this, I would now like to introduce to you the ABCD matrix. An ABCD matrix is a very, very nice formalism to representing an optical component. Effectively, as we take components in optics, for instance a lens, or a distance apart, or a mirror, or all those things, and we matrix multiply them together, we form another ABCD matrix that represents that optical system. And at the end of our matrix multiplication, each of the components of the ABCD matrix corresponds to these values here. Specifically for this project, we're most concerned with the A value, which is the magnification, and the C value, which is negative 1 over the focal length. So, if we can get C to be 0, it's the same as having F be infinity, because 1 over infinity is equal to 0. So for our system, we're going to start with the light first going through a first lens, which is going to be given by this thin lens matrix here, and then we're going to have the light propagate some distance d through material, which in this case will just be air, so that propagation matrix will go now here, and then it's going to interact with the final lens, which we'll throw here. As you can see here, I have the propagation distance between the two lenses as d, and I have the focal length of each respective lens as f1 and f2. Now doing some matrix multiplication, we end up with this final ABCD matrix. Now from our previous discussion, if we want the light to be collimated, we know that the expression in the C component of the matrix must be equal to 0. So doing a little bit of algebra, solving this equation out for d, we can see that d must be equal to the sum of the focal lengths of each respective lens. So that sums up everything you need to know about collimating the light. However, I'm guessing for a lot of you, if you just found a lens out of some system, you have no idea what the focal length is. So to demonstrate to you all how you can measure the focal length of a lens, I'm going to do it for this little lens here, which came as part of this helping hand set, and I have no idea what its focal length is. To find the focal length, we make use of a simple equation. That's 1 over O plus 1 over I is equal to 1 over F. In this case, the O stands for the distance between the object and the lens, the I stands for the distance between the lens and the image, and F is the focal length. There are quite a few simple ways that you can do this. I find the easiest ones to be imaging objects that are already emitting light. So for instance, you could use your phone's flashlight, shine that down, and then see by moving the lens where it produces a nice image of it. However, if I'm already in a tall room with lights, then it can almost be like the object is infinitely far away. So it would be like 1 over a large number is kind of like 0, so you can find a nice approximation for the focal length just by measuring the distance from the lens to the ground that you image the object with. But of course, it's better to know the distance already of both of them. So now as I take this lens and I move it towards the ground, you can start to see it focusing the light down. Right now it's too blurry. Now it's too blurry, and if I move it too close, you can see it gets too blurry. But right here, you can see a clear image of the object. So I can see the two fluorescent light bulb tubes going through it. And for me, it looks like that's about 19.5 centimeters. So now, given that the distance from the image to the lens was around 19.5 centimeters, and that the distance from the object to the lens was around 290 centimeters, we can conclude that the focal length is around 18 centimeters. So with that information, hopefully without an expensive optics kit, and just using lenses that you can scrounge apart from different things, you guys should still be able to collimate your light. And here we have the Michelson interferometer implemented. Over here I have a laser, which I borrowed from my local university because it's mounted inside this metal block here, which makes it really easy to mount to this optics table. Next up I have these two lenses, which are placed the sum of their focal lengths apart from one another. Now if you're working with a laser like I am, you really don't need this because the laser's probably already very well collimated. Regardless, if you do have it implemented into your optics system, you'll find that if you have it precisely set up enough, that it will overall improve your results. Next we have our beam splitter, which will separate the laser into two different paths and send it down each of the mirror's arm lengths. If we follow this path, we have one half of the laser go this way, then it bounces back, and then we have half of the laser go this way and half of the laser come back through the beam splitter. Alternatively, if we follow this path, first off we have the laser going through the beam splitter, bounces off this mirror, comes back down, half of it reflects out this direction, and half of it comes back the direction that it came originally. Finally, I have this lens at the output to magnify the image so that it's a little bit easier to see the deconstructive interference fringes caused by the beams combining back together and heading down that path. Now with the laser turned on, we can take a look at the output. When I first turn it on, I see these two dots formed by the beams coming from each of the respective mirrors. However, now watch as I tilt one of the mirrors to get the dots to come together. As you can see, we can start to see an interference pattern happen between them. Now if you want to really see the changes in the fringes on your interferometer, you have to get the dots to as close as on top of each other as you can. Now of course by eyeballing it, we can get them pretty close together, but there comes a point around right here when it's pretty hard just by eyeballing it. So at this point to get them lined up, I like to look at the fringes formed. So if we look at those black lines going up and down, if we were to imagine the perpendicular portion to that, that's the direction they need to move in. We want to keep on going until those fringes disappear. So seeing that the fringes are near perfectly up and down, that means I want to move horizontally. So as I move horizontally, you can see the fringes become a little bit thicker, and there comes a point when the fringes are really thick. And right here, for instance, the fringes are so thick that we actually see nothing. However, if I push down slightly on the table I'm using, we can see that the fringes are more happening in the up and down direction, almost. It's kind of like a 45 degree angle, actually. So we're nearly there. If I move it up and down, of course, you can also see that then we start to get the fringes that way. So you can really use this to try and orient where you're trying to get to. And I can tell it's not exactly precise because as I hit it, you can kind of see there's a rolling motion to it getting dimmer. However, this is exactly like the simulation I was showing you. For instance, as I'm pushing down on the table, and this isn't on the actual optic board setup, this is on the opposite end of a long table, you can see as I push on it, you can see it get a little bit dimmer, and then there comes a part where it starts to get brighter again. And so this is the motion of just pushing on it. We're going through those fringes. Now, if they were perfectly lined up in an ideal world with all my lenses perfectly clean, then we would assume that it would get completely black as we see in the simulation. However, we don't have all that, so it just gets dimmer. But we can definitely see when it gets dimmer versus brighter. To show you guys how sensitive this thing is, I'm going to clap on the opposite side of the room. Now this guy is extremely precise, because every change like this that you see going from bright to dim is a change of just half a wavelength of light relative to the distance between the two mirrors. And so, since we're using here a laser that's like 530 nanometers, that means every single change that you see happening is a distance of 265 nanometers approximately, which is a very small distance. And like I said, you can set up interferometers with things like X-rays or even matter waves to get much, much smaller measurements. Anyways, with measurement sensitivity like this, it's not hard to see why this kind of tool was the tool of choice used for measuring gravity waves. Now introducing a lens into the system, you can see that the fringes take on a sort of spherical shape, and this is caused by the curvature of the lens. So yeah, this is an example of a very picturesque, very standard picture that you see when people talk about interferometry. However, I think it's better without the lens, just looking at that one dot there that goes from the bright to the dim, because it's a little bit easier to tell what's going on if you're just focusing on that one point. Now we are going to use this to measure the wavelength of light, but I decided I'm going to put that into part two of this video, which will probably come out exactly a week after this video comes out. So, with that said, I guess we reached the end of the video. If you enjoyed it and or learned something new, I'd really appreciate it if you'd hit that thumbs up button. And if you'd like to see more videos like this, which is hopefully gonna get more frequent because my college experience is starting to die down now, then go ahead and hit that subscribe button for me so that they show up in your subscription newsfeed. And if you have a topic that you'd like to see covered, go ahead and leave it in the comment section below. This can be any kind of physics experiment, any coding, any electrical engineering, any chemistry, anything like that would be pretty fun to do. So that's everything. Always remember how an experiment can hurt you. In this case, we have lasers, and lasers can make you go blind. So don't shine it in your eye. And with that said, please remember to be safe and have a wonderful day. I'll see you guys next time.
You're watching Keystone Science, and in today's episode, we're going to explore and experimentally demonstrate Bell's inequality.